Listening Library presents Kids of Appetite by David Arnold. Read for you by Ryan Vincent Anderson, Michael Crouch, and Phoebe Strole. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes a character list which can be viewed by opening the accompanying PDF file on any Mac or PC computer. For my brothers, Jeremy and AJ, the original KOA. And in memory of my two grandfathers, a couple of real super racehorses. It seemed funny to me that the sunset she saw from her patio and the one I saw from the back steps was the same one. Maybe the two different worlds we lived in weren't so different. We saw the same sunset. The Outsiders, S. E. Hinton. 1. The Momentous Multitudes, or Gird Thy Silly Futile Selves. Interrogation Room Number 3. Bruno Victor Benucci III and Sergeant S. Mendez. December 19, 3:12 p.m.
Consider this. Billions of people in the world, each with billions of I ams. I am a quiet observer, a champion wallflower. I am a lover of art, the Mets, the memory of Dad. I represent approximately 1/7 billionth of the population. These are my momentous multitudes, and that's just for starters. It begins with my friends. What does? My story, I say. Only that's not quite right. I have to go back further than that. Before we were friends. Back when it was just... Okay, got it. I've fallen in love something like 1,000 times. Mendez smiles a little. Nudges the digital recorder closer. I'm sorry, you said you've fallen in love? 1,000 times, I say, running both hands through my hair. I used to think love was bound by numbers. First kisses, second dances, infinite heartbreaks. I used to think numbers outlasted the love itself. Surviving in the dark corners of the demolished heart. I used to think love was heavy and hard. I don't think those things anymore. I am a super racehorse. You're a what? Asks Mendez, her eyes at once tough and tired. Nothing. Where's your uniform? She wears a tweed skirt with a fitted jacket and flowy blouse. I quietly observe her brown eyes, very intense, and, were it not for the baggy pillows and the crow's feet framing her features like facial parentheses, quite pretty. I quietly observe the slight creases on her hands and neck, indicative of premature aging. I quietly observe the absence of a wedding ring. I quietly observe her dark hair, shoulder length, with just a lingering shadow of shape and style. Parenthetical, slight, absence, lingering. The momentous multitudes of Mendez, it seems, are found in the hushed footnote. Technically, I'm off duty, she says. Plus, I'm a sergeant, so I don't always have to wear a uniform. So you're the one in charge, right? I report to Lieutenant Bell, but this is my case, if that's what you're asking. I reach under my chair, pull my visine out of the front pocket of my backpack, and apply a quick drop in each eye. Victor, you've been missing 8 days. Then this morning you and... She shuffles through papers until finding the one she's looking for. Madeline Falco march in here, practically holding hands with Mbemba Bahizire Kabongo, a.k.a. Baz, the primary suspect in our murder investigation. I wasn't holding hands with Baz. And he's no murderer. You don't think so? I know so. Mendez gives me a pity smile, the kind of smile that frowns. He just turned himself in, Vic. That, plus his DNA, is on the murder weapon. We have more than enough to put Kabongo behind bars for a very long time. What I'm hoping you might shed some light on is how you go from running out the front door of your own home 8 days ago to walking in here this morning. You said you have a story to tell. So tell it. This morning's memory is fresh. Baz's voice ingrained in my brain. Diversion tactics, Vic. They will need time, and we must give it to them. Every girl who wears eyeliner, I say. Sergeant Mendez squints. What? Every girl who plays an instrument, except maybe not bassoon. I'm sorry, I don't under... Every girl who wears old Nikes. Every girl who draws on them. Every girl who shrugs or bakes or reads. Tell them about all the girls you thought you loved, the ones from before. I smile on the inside, the only place I can. Every girl who rides a bike. I pull out my handkerchief and dab the drool from the corner of my mouth. Dad called it my leaky mug. I used to hate that. Now I miss it. Sometimes. Yes, I think I miss the hated things most. Mendez leans back in her chair. Shortly after you left, your mom reported you missing. I've been in your room, Vic. It's all Whitman and Salinger and Matisse. You're smart. And kind of a nerd, if you don't mind my saying. What's your point? My point is, you're no hard ass. So why are you acting like one? Under the metal table, I pick at the fabric of my KOA wristband. I am large. I contain multitudes. Mendez picks up. I concentrate toward them that are nigh. I wait on the door slab. Who has done his day's work? Who will soonest be through with his supper? Who wishes to walk with me? I try to hide my shock, but I can't be sure my eyes didn't just give me away. Whitman balanced out the criminal justice classes, says Mendez. You know what the next line is, don't you? I don't, so I say nothing at all. Will you speak before I am gone? She says quietly. Will you prove already too late? Due respect, Miss Mendez, you don't know me. She looks back at the file in front of her. Bruno Victor Benucci III, 16, son of Doris Jacoby Benucci, and the late Bruno Benucci Jr., deceased 2 years. Only child. 5'6", dark hair, suffers from the rare Mobius syndrome. Obsession with abstract art. Do you know what that is? Oh, I've had my share of Picasso-obsessed crooks, let me tell you. It's no picnic. That's not what I meant. I know what you meant. Mendez flips the file shut. And yeah, I did some research. Mobius is a rare neurological disorder affecting the 6th and 7th cranial nerves, present from birth, causing facial paralysis. I understand it's been difficult for you. Mendez's tone suggests a hint of self-satisfaction, as if she's been sitting on this definition, just waiting for me to ask if she knew what was wrong with my face. I've had Mobius syndrome my whole life, and here is what I've learned. The only people arrogant enough to use the words, "I understand," are the ones who can't possibly understand. People who truly get it never say much of anything. You did some research, I say, barely above a whisper. A little. So you know what it feels like to have sand shoved up your eyelids. What? That's what it's like sometimes, not being able to blink, I say. Dry eye doesn't begin to describe it. More like desert eye. Vic, did your research offer insight into the night terrors that come from sleeping with your eyes half shut? Or how drinking from a cup feels about as possible as lassoing the moon? Or how the best I can hope for is that kids just leave me alone? Or how certain teachers slow down when talking to me because they assume I'm stupid? Mendez shifts uncomfortably in her chair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.